My party colleagues have touched on many aspects of the proposal. I wish to highlight the part that I have the most concern with. It is the way ministers' pay is pegged to the top 1,000 Singapore earners. The Salary Review Committee was given the terms of reference by the Prime Minister to, quote, take into account salaries of comparable jobs in the private sector and also other reference points such as the general wage levels in Singapore, unquote. The assumption this government began with is that political talent is synonymous with career success, that office holders must have comparable pays with top private sector earners. So the committee arrived at the median income of the top 1,000 earners, less a 40% discount, to, quote, signify the ethos and sacrifice that comes with political service, unquote. It implies that our political office holders must come from this pool, or that their ability and job scope is equivalent to the top 0.06% of the working Singapore population. This sentiment has indeed been expressed by the Deputy Prime Minister and by various members over the past 2 days. We have constantly used this mindset since 1994, when ministers' pay was first revamped to tie it to the top earners in the private sector. While the committee's new formula is better than that of the previous one, which has been narrowly tied with only the top 8 earners in 6 professions, it is nevertheless still an elitist thinking that only those who are top in their professional careers can make it to hold political office. Running a company well is different from being able to run a country. Perhaps this government has treated running this country too much like running a business that we have often been referred to as Singapore Inc. So we also tie political work to that of running a very big company. I believe this is a flawed model. In constantly drumming this message since 1994, we have created an expectation among potential office, political office holders that political office is a career progression for them, and that reaching a minister's position is like reaching the pinnacles of one career. It creates an expectation amongst potential office holders that they need a safe route to parachute into parliament or they would not risk their career. This has made Singapore politics uniquely Singapore. It is a model of politics that, despite years of attempt to justify and fine-tune, many have yet to accept. I, for one, do not accept this model. I feel we have over-commercialized the nature of running this country. We need to constantly remind ourselves that we have been elected by the people into this house. It is totally different from being headhunted to be a hired top management of a company. We should never forget it is a noble calling to serve the public. I'd like to ask, what aspires a person to take the difficult route of politics? 4 years ago, I read with interest about how President Obama, as a young student in an Indonesian school, stated that his ambition was to be the President of the United States of America. It was a noble aspiration for a child, an almost impossible ambition given his family background and that he was half the world away from America. Why would he have such an aspiration? As a child, growing up in post-independence Singapore, I have been influenced by several of our first generation leaders whom I had clearly seen have made great sacrifices and have made great improvements to the country by what they did. Now I wonder what would aspire our future generations to want to become ministers and to be the future Prime Minister of Singapore. I certainly hope it will not be for career progression. I share the Prime Minister's concern that Singapore needs good and high-ability people to be able to protect what we have. Now, we have often heard that Singapore does not have enough for two teams. I do not agree with this thinking. I have more confidence in our people. During the debate on the President's address, I had called for political education in schools. It is to strengthen the knowledge of our youth in the functioning of Parliament and of the government. I believe it is important to instill this sense of public service and political awareness in our youth to give them a better understanding of issues important to our country. We should aim to create aspiring future politicians who will believe strongly in the importance of leading the nation and that they wish to play a part in it. Perhaps it is also how we have constantly looked for political talent from amongst a narrow pool of top career performers that has perpetuated lack of interest in political careers amongst the general population. I believe we have been talent ponding for far too long, searching from a small pond for people that fit as career elites. We should instead talent flood with people from all walks of life. The Salary Review Committee describes a 40% discount as a sacrifice for political service. I personally do not like the word sacrifice, a term that has been used by various members throughout the last 2 days. Being a politician should be an aspiration and an honor. It is the nature of politics all over the world that there will be public scrutiny. There will be challenges balancing family and work. There will be setbacks, such as loss in the electoral votes. The reluctant will deem this as sacrifices. Those who aspire to lead will welcome this as challenges to be overcome. Singaporeans do not expect politicians to live a Spartan life with a religious calling. I believe Singapore politics has been more than fair to our political office holder for the past 2 decades. Even with the levels proposed by the Workers' Party, the political office holders can live very dignified lives. Now, we hear examples of former US and UK and other political leaders earning a lot after retirement. I think life has been fair to our retiring political leaders as well. We see that retiring ministers are sought after by our government-linked companies and some by multinationals. I believe the experience they have gained while in office have also increased their market value. Some members have said that the Workers' Party proposal supports the level of salaries proposed by the committee, just because we happen to arrive at roughly the same basic monthly salary for an entry-level minister. The differences are several, but important. Number one, we start with the allowance for a member of parliament because, firstly, a minister is a member of parliament. It is a reminder that we are elected by the people, not selected by a powerful committee to become ministers. Secondly, the base salary for entry-grade senior civil servants at MX Grade 9 is less subjected to fluctuation compared with incomes at the 500 and 501st top income earners, which is the median of the top 1,000 income earners. Over time, by comparing with the top, we could again see the salaries of ministers rising faster than are acceptable to Singaporeans, as my colleague Mr. Yao has shared earlier. Thirdly, we oppose the huge bonus payout. Again, I like to say that while we like Singapore to be well-run, Singapore is not just a very big company. As an entrepreneur, Mr. Inderjit Singh is acceptable with huge bonuses of 13 and a half months. That may be the practice of some very generous private companies. Politically, it is unheard of, and it is unacceptable to the electorate. The bonus for any political party will come at the ballot boxes. Now, I'd like to thank the Prime Minister for acknowledging that the Workers' Party pay formula works out to be less than what the committee has proposed. I believe Mr. Vikram Nair and Madam Halimah Yacob could check with the Prime Minister on how he arrived at the calculation. Now, our computation, the benchmark points annual salary for the entry-level minister with 13-month bonus and an average 2.5-month bonus is $852,500 compared with the $1.1 million as recommended by the committee. This is a 46% cut from the 2010 annual pay. Furthermore, a portion of the bonus is deferred into a bonus bank. Under our proposal, the Prime Minister with 13-month and 2.5-month bonus will receive $1,534,500 compared with the recommended $2.2 million. This is a 50% cut from the 2010 annual level, annual pay. Now, before I conclude, I just like to address a point that Mr. Vikram Nair has brought up, that he seems to have harped twice on what we have contributed to Mr. Gerard Yee's proposals and to the committee. Now, my colleague, Mr. Gerald Giam, has already shared that he has met with the committee, and he has given me permission to share that he has spent more than 2 hours with the committee. Now, I wonder how many hours did Mr. Vikram Nair spend with the committee? During the discussion, Gerald has shared many of the principles that are in the current Workers' Party proposal, including deferred bonus, KPIs, or benchmarking practices, and so on. Now, we do not feel that we have to give everything to the committee, and this is precisely what the Parliament is here for. The Parliament is the place where we will debate the whole proposal. I'm not sure if Mr. Vikram Nair expects that we are here to just rubber stamp the proposal. We are here to debate the proposal, and you know, according to his speech, he said that if we are the opposed, then we are supporting the previous pay level. I believe the Parliament is where we come up with another proposal to be decided upon. Okay. In conclusion, the annual levels that we have proposed are not the same as that of the Reviews Committee. More fundamentally, we object to the principles used to set the benchmarks for the ministerial salaries. Therefore, I oppose the motion.